I examine myself. I'm not going in there. No, I ain't. I'm not going in there. I ain't. You don't have to put no bells around. I'm not going in there. Come on here, y'all. That might be a day I wasn't living right. Don't let nobody force you into nothing. Yom Kippur, the day of repentance, and concludes with Yom Kippur, the day of atonement. In Hebrew, Rosh Hashanah means the opening of the gate. God want to open up a gate in your life. He wants you to open up to what? Prosperity, goodwill. Everything seems bad. Every time you cut on the TV, you know, I mean, there's so much bad news, you know. Yeah. Hey, you know, I was kind of looking at the game yesterday, and I had to cut the game off because I got a little bit too emotional in there. So I ain't going to even ask who won that game yesterday, so don't say nothing. All right, so come on here. It says it's the opening of heaven's gate, just as we offer, reflect, self-evaluate ourselves on New Year's Day, January 1st. We also judge ourselves on Rosh Hashanah. Judge yourself. My judge is not to be here and worry about Sister Janice, what she's doing. That ain't my job. My job is to keep myself right. Huh? Keep my tongue right. Mm-hmm. Death and life is in the power of your what? We judge ourselves on Rosh Hashanah. Am I paying my, it's not paying, but it's giving my tithe. Uh-oh. I'm hitting something now. Am I sacrificing, you know, doing things that are right? Am I being kind? Some folks, oh, they mean as hell. Come on here. Am I kind? Am I forgiving? Uh-oh. People stay out of church because they ain't forgave nobody. Because Reverend so-and-so did something. Well, that Reverend so-and-so got to go before God himself. Am I gracious? Am I loving? People tickle me trying to be loving. I seen one person I knew. This person so messed up. And I said, even when they smile, they messed up. I know they ain't loving. Trying to put on a front smile. You're not just so full of hate. Come on here. These are not requirements for salvation, but they are ways fulfilling the two commandments that Jesus said, fulfill all the law and the prophets, love of God and love of others. If we are walking with Christ in this, the gates of the kingdom are open for us with all the blessings of heaven. God wants us to get rid of all the stuff that's not right. He's given us 10 days. Then the glorious church of Jesus Christ will be without spot or wrinkle. I have a spot without spot or wrinkle because of the blood of Jesus. Listen, I'm still no good. I'm still capable of doing terrible things. You are too. Anybody that don't come to prayer, they thinking is off. You ain't getting prayer somewhere. Now, I'm not saying you have to come up here and pray like we got it. But, you know, if you stay out of prayer too long now, and then most folks, they're not praying at home. They're not praying at home because too much hell going up in there. Too much distractions going on. Sometimes you have to whoop Junior's behind. That goes for children and grandchildren. Get some peace in the home. And sometimes husband and wife got to stop yelling and screaming at one another. My God, I thought, is that a Christian home? They curse and count and fight? Oh, my God. It's time for what? Repentance. Some folk tickle me. They don't yell and scream, but they got a certain look they look. They got an evil look, an evil eye on one another. Come on in. Oh, my God. Repent. 10 days of repentance and getting right with God. Okay, let me see. All right. Psalms 118:16. Now, I know you probably can't pull it, but I got it right here. 118:16 through it. It says, the right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does violently. I shall not die, but live. How many want to live this next year? You know, I mean, hey, we all suffer with pain. You know, we have aches and pains, but yet and still, I want to live. We had a friend that died, and he had a terrible disease, but he said, I yet want to live. But you know what? If God would raise a lot of people up, they wouldn't live for him. Come on here and talk to me. They wouldn't live for God. That's why God allowed people to repent and he take them on there, because they're not going to do right. You may be listening to me on YouTube. God has given you chance after chance. Now your chances are running out. God wants complete surrender. I shall live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. God has chastised me. Anybody ever been chastised? God always chastises his people because we need to be chastised. When I was coming up, you're going to get your behind whooped for the things that you've done. I mean, one time they told us not to set the trash on fire. They used to let you burn trash. They said don't burn trash because it's dry. I went out there and started a fire, and the fire almost burned up the neighborhood. And I knew I was gonna get my behind kicked. I was gonna get horse whooped, boy. And what I did, I ran away from home because I knew my punishment was gonna be severe. I let my brother take the rap. Stayed away for 3 days, and the people's asking, where you live at? Your parents know where you at? Oh, my God. But anyway, we're going to stop there. He said, in the next year, I will live and not die. I won't go broke. You really need to celebrate the feast days. Highest gas is. Highest groceries is. Everything's sky high now. They're not going to be happy until they push it up to $5 a gallon here in Oklahoma. That's what they're shooting for. All that's been planned. And then if they can't get you on an economic thing, they cause some catastrophic event to happen to wake you up. When are you going to wake up? You still sleep. You're in a coma. It's time to wake up. I won't get sick. They tried to put COVID on you. We all survived COVID over here at this church. We didn't have no masks and we didn't have no shots. All we had was the power of God, the word of God. And we survived. Not only did we survive, we thrived. Oh, y'all got quiet in here. I won't get sick. And if I do get sick, I will be healed. My marriage won't die. What a divorce court is just filled. Oklahoma got one of the highest marriage and divorce courts in America. People just don't get along. You know, you need to get counseling before you get married. Now, before you get married, look that woman over. Look that man over. Now, are you willing to spend your life with him or her? Huh? Now, 10, 15 years from now, they're not going to look the same. 34, 40 years from now, his hair will be great. And he probably won't have no hair. You still want to be married? That's in the marriage vows. You married a bald head man? Oh, my God. Huh? Her front tooth came oh, Lord, it came out. You sure you still want to be married to the same person? Better make up your mind before you make that commitment. It says until death. What? I know when I was getting ready to marry my wife, an honest confession is good for the soul. And I didn't know that this preacher was going to say, you're going to leave all others alone. Now, I think he put that in there. But I was saying to myself, now, you know, I don't know. I mean, I want to, but, you know, I said I do, but I said, you know, I'll be lying in front of all these people. No good and well, I ain't going to, well, so much for that. Just like a lot of y'all said, you're going to do it and you didn't do it. Keep your vows. May God help us. My marriage won't die. You know, you can have a good marriage now. Some men say, yeah, we're doing pretty good. We get along like two peas in a pod.
Yeah, you wait till that heat hit them peas. We're going to see how good you're going to get along. Marriage is beautiful, though. Huh? I know when I got married, I looked my wife over and over. I said, now, is this what you want to, you want to be with her the rest of your life?
I said, well, yes, I do. You know, I don't know, you know.
But if you give it to God, God will fix it. God will fix it where you will love one another, even in your old age. Even when you're kind of forgetful. See, that's when you need one another. When one person gets forgetful, then the other one can make them think. All right, all right. I'm going to live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has chastised me severely. What does that mean? In Israel, during every day in the 30 days leading to Rosh Hashanah, the rabbis would blow that ancient trumpet, the shofar. The shofar is powerful. The shofar was a warning that Rosh Hashanah was coming. During those 30 days, God would speak to his people. God would speak to his people. Some folk, if God would speak to them, it'd scare them. And then some folks so naive, they don't even know when God is speaking to them. One thing I know about God, when he speaks to you, it's real calm. One of the greatest prophets it was missed God because he thought God was in the tornado and the wind blowing. No, he wasn't. God came to him in a small, still voice. He was like that because Jezebel had what? Terrorized him. Jezebel had him on the run, had a man of God on the run. A woman named Jezebel had that old boy on the run. Run him up in a cave. He said, I'm going to get you. He's supposed to be a man of God, supposed to be hearing from God. That's the time that he needed some therapy. All right. During those 30 days, God would speak to his people. You have been gossiping. Uh-oh. You have been backbiting. If you hear something negative about somebody, don't dig into it. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. Huh? If you see somebody coming out of, a saint of God coming out of Lickstone, leave it alone. I know I've told y'all this here. Me and my wife was just got married. And, you know, we had this check and everything closed. And she had a cousin that owned a liquor store. And he would cash your check. And I didn't want nobody to see me coming out of that liquor store. So I was trying to send her, yeah, go on in there and cash the check. I was trying to get the woman, you know. So she said, no, you come in here with me. I said, I don't know him. She said, you come on in here with me. So we went in there and cashed the check. Man, he cashed that check. And as we were coming out the door, man, I was looking around to see if Elder So-and-so, or brother, so I seen him and his wife coming out of the liquor store. I suppose I would have stumbled on a rock or something. Oh, yeah, he was drunk, man. He come out of there. I seen him. All right, all right. Let me, y'all made me lose my place here. Come on here. The people were aware that they had not forgiven others and the next year would not be good. If they had been gossiping and hurtful, the next year would not be good. I want this to be a good, sweet year. So what? God gave us 10 days to repent. The good news was he has not given me over to death. This could be the best year of your life. Last year was a good year for me. And the year before was a good year. Oh, hey, I got sick. I went to Wichita twice, and every time I got back, I got sick. I don't know what was going on around there. Were they blowing COVID around there? Or what? Went to a wedding and got back? I don't know what was going on. Somebody said they had a tornado there and the wind. It was all in the wind. But I got sick, but I got well. God's not saying that you might get sick, not because you're disobedient, because the world is so evil now. People are putting chemicals out there to make you sick. Oh, y'all don't believe that, do you? They spraying stuff up in there to make you sick. All right, all right. The good news was he has not given us over to death. In other words, we may have been doing some things, some bad things. God's a merciful God. But God has not given up. God has not given up on us. God still want to work with it. He is blowing that trumpet. You know, we recited a prayer last night about Manasseh. Manasseh prayed, brother. Listen, Manasseh was a terrible king. He set up idolatry, the groves. He was doing all kind of sex immorality. And, you know, dope and all that kind of, he was doing everything. And after something happened in his life and he repented. And we had a prayer in the book of, I think it was 2 Chronicles, I don't have it. But he repented a prayer. And I said, man, that is a God-sent prayer that man prayed. Oh my God, that's a prayer of showing up repentance. God is calling us as people of God to repent. If you want to live a long time, learn how to forgive people. I heard one man said he lived to be 100 years old because he drunk whiskey every day. Well, maybe, I don't know. Then I heard another man, godly man, said he'd live a long time because he learned how to forgive. I think I'd rather be on the end where I learn how to forgive and not drink whiskey every day. Okay, all right, so much for that. Give it up on me. In the old things, a new beginning. Listen, this is a time of new beginnings. How many want a new beginning? This is your time on Rosh Hashanah to get a new beginning. A new beginning. A new beginning is on the way. Old things are passed away. All things are become new. That's 2 Corinthians 5:17. Okay. And I'm going to look at Psalms 118. It says, open to me the gates of righteousness. God want to open up something to you if you're serious about your walk with God. Those loved ones that are not saved and that are bitter, God want to save them. You know, the best way to pray for people and the best way to deal with situations that come up in our lives is not just pray that they'll become a better person, but pray that I will become a better person. I will go through them and I will praise the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous shall enter. Remember, the word righteous is the Hebrew word meaning charity. We are saved because of God's charity. We're not here saved because I stopped going to the club and I stopped drinking or blowing whiskey or whatever, blowing my money. No, I'm not saved because of it. I'm saved because of God's charity. Y'all ever heard the saying, we're saved by grace, are you saved? And grace alone. He looked at us and sent Jesus to be our Mashiach, to die so that we might live. We are the righteousness of God. We are God's acts of charity. You know, you are an act of charity. How many of y'all love God? If you love God, then act like you love him. Do the things that are please him. Don't please me. Don't please a preacher. Please God. Let's look back at the names associated with Rosh Hashanah. Rosh means new. Say Rosh means new. Year. So this is the new year for you and I. We're starting off with a new year, y'all. You ain't gotta work to wait till January the 1st. Dun, 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 dun. Come on, y'all. Before you leave, you drunk. Come on here. Before you leave, you're looking at another woman. Come on here. That ain't the way we celebrate. That's the way of the world. But we're celebrating a new year in what? Righteousness and holiness. So this is the new year on God's calendar. There are two new years. Passover is a spiritual new year when you and I were born spiritually. It is the day when Jesus died on the cross, the last supper in which Jesus led his followers in what we now call communion. Was actually celebration of Passover. He broke the bread, his body, and drank the cup, his blood, in order to say, in effect, I am the Passover lamb. Passover, therefore, is a spiritual new year. Rosh Hashanah is the physical new year. Rosh Hashanah means physical or civil year. It is similar to how some Christians celebrate their physical birthdays and days. Now, some people get so fanatical, they don't believe in celebrating birthdays. Okay, you don't believe in saluting the flag. Okay. You don't believe in, what other things? You don't believe in going to a ball game. Okay. You don't believe in celebrating. Now, come on, man. You got to believe in something. I believe you can celebrate a birthday because that's God's day of letting you know when you was born. At least you're still living where you can celebrate a birthday. So give God praise. The days they were born and their spiritual birthdays, the days we were born again. Some folk remember when they were born again, the day and the hour. I don't remember mine, but I know it happened. Born again means to be born from above.
Okay. He wipes away the last year through Jesus Christ. Now, what you did last year is all in the past. Now we're starting anew now. This is going to be a sweet year. The only way we can share in this is if we have Jesus, so that we have been grafted in, Romans 11:16, with those covenant promises. If you have Jesus, the Abraham covenants are also ours. The Feast of Trumpets, the Talmud. I'm almost through. It's something else I want to bring in here. Here's something good here we need to know. The blowing of the shofar is a call to worship. It calls the lukewarm back to worship. It's a whole lot in Rosh Hashanah. It's a whole lot in the feast days. Huh? More good things that happen on feast days. Third is the blowing of the trumpet, called to worship. It's called those lukewarm Christians. What's a lukewarm? What does lukewarm mean? You ain't cold. You ain't hot. Make up your mind what you gonna do. Somebody said they want to be hot. They want to be on fire. God, light my fire. I'm tired of being lukewarm. Either you're in or you're out. Therefore, he says, awake. Ephesians 5:14-16 says, therefore, he says, awake you who sleep. You sleep. The church is what? Falling asleep. Some folks, they're in a coma. You couldn't wake them up if you tried. But that's a God thing. Awake you who sleep. Arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. This is to the church. So then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools. You got a lot of fools in the church. They don't believe nothing. They don't even go to church. They don't. My God, brother, you on dangerous territory. You on dangerous territory. But as wise. How many want to be wise? I want to be wise. Say, I want to be wise. Redeeming the time, because the days are evil. God wants us to redeem the time. Here the Apostle Paul quoted the book of Isaiah, said, wake up. Say, wake up. Wake up. Wake up. Turn around and tell somebody to wake up. There you go. Wake up. Wake up. We're in a war, y'all. Spiritual war. We got to wake up. Wake up. Hear the sound of the trumpet. The trumpet will sound to wake the people up. You know, I'm afraid. I don't mean I'm not afraid, but I'm reluctant that a lot of y'all, including me, had a chance to witness and share your testimony with somebody that's not saved and they died. It could be that their blood be on your hands. Hmm? You better examine yourself. Every time you got a chance. I'm so happy that me and the wife went up to see her uncle just before he died. And I was trying to find every excuse not to go up there. Oh, God, he might be drunk. I mean, he might be drinking in the hospital, you know. And then I had this old raggedy car. I didn't know if this old car was going to make it to Muskogee. Say, God, now here's a good excuse. This car might stop on the highway. Just kept making up excuses. But the wife kept on saying, no, we got to go. We got to go see my uncle. Went up there and seen him, prayed for him, led him in the sinner's prayer. Went back home. They called up and said he dead. My hands, I said, God, I thank you. Ooh, I thank you, God. I went up there. We obeyed you. He made it in. And when I preached his funeral, I was so happy, man. It was easy to preach because why? He made it in. Absent from the body means to be present with the Lord. He repented. She had another cousin. Well, her cousin this time. He said they was trying to get him to take burial for, you know, because he dead. He said, I ain't taking nothing now. They said, well, who gonna bury? He said, y'all. Got a chance to go to the hospital. I didn't go in because my knees so bad, but I let the first lady go in. No, I went the first time. I went in there. And I had my stick with me just in case my knees. Went up there, and she went through the sinner's prayer with it. Y'all hear what I said? Now I could find any kind of excuse. I don't feel like going up there. My knees is, no. We went up there anyway. That was our time to get him. Prayed the sinner's prayer for him. He repented. Got saved. And then we went up with Maurice. Oh, my God. And Mario had been ministering to him all the time. And the wife said, have y'all led him into the sinner's prayer? Got a chance to lead him into the sinner's prayer. He got saved. Come on in. He said, I'm ready now. Glory to God. Obeying God. This all happened because what? We celebrate the feast days. And God led us to do this. God want to lead you to do the same thing. They in the hospital waiting for somebody to come to lead them in a sinner's prayer. They might be in their homes waiting on you to come by there. You got the keys. The church has got the keys. Because the church is the power of God. It's the eye of God. The church. The church ain't get up and talk about it because people do wrong things. The church ain't lost its power. It's still strong. Why? Because Jesus is the church. And he's been risen from what? The dead. These feast days are all about Christ. His death, his burial, his resurrection, and his second coming. Sukkoth is talking about when they spent time in the wilderness. And God fed them. He clothed them. Gave them water to drink. Hey, you go 3 days with water, your mouth sure is going to get dry. It's going to be some hollering and cussing and everything else. You go 3 days without water. And God told Moses, I guess he smoked the rock or speak to the rock. And Moses got so frustrated with the people until he probably called them all kind of names too. Come on here, he's human. Called them a bunch of rebels. Said, I hope you die out here. He was so mad. Oh my God. But God said, no, you don't do my people. I don't care how bad they are. Them is my people. And because of that, you're not going over into the promised land. Oh, my God. So let's not get frustrated with one another. Come on here. I've heard people tell me, I hope you die. And they die. The scriptures say, I live and not die. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All right, we're going to close up. We're going to close up. Thank you for being such a wonderful audience. You out there in Listed Land, if you want to learn how to celebrate these feast days, come out tonight. At 7:30, we're gonna go back over some more of them. This is the third day. This will conclude Rosh Hashanah, and we're going right on into Yom Kippur, the repentance, and watch God work in your life. Be blessed.
Hi friends, my name's Pastor Larry Ingram along with my wife Carolyn. Come join us on this network for preaching, teaching, and our healing services.
Come join us and be blessed.